How is everybody today? That's exactly right. Yeah? We're going to start off with a little bit of scripture. It said, and it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. This taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. And Joseph went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. I had never paid any attention to what verse 6 says, and said, so it was while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. Not the baby, but her. Amen. Jesus Christ is the reason we are here. There is no other reason. No other reason for anything, for any of us to do. Everything we do is by His will and through His grace. Amen?
Amen.
Amanda, open us in a word of prayer. Amen. Let's stand and sing. And if you want to get a hymnal, of course, I can guarantee you everybody knows this song, but just in case, it is on page 366. Let's all sing. Silent Night. Silent night, holy Amen. You can be seated. Somebody give us a word of testimony.
Woke up this morning.
Yes, sir. Somebody else.
I just want to thank the good Lord for helping me get through this season. Helping me get through Thanksgiving. He's always there. You just have to call out his name.
Yep. Exactly right. Somebody else.
One of my cousin's children in Missouri went home from the hospital, Colton. I heard today they're going to try to wean Mackenzie off the ventilator and get her lungs stronger so that hopefully they can get her home by the end of the year.
Amen. Anybody else?
I'd like to say that last Sunday was a very special Sunday for me. This church was, it just means so much to me. And I want to thank you and everybody here for what you do. Just being here, being feeling
the
feels that I feel.
Yeah. Amen.
Thank you.
You are a big part of why we do what we do, brother.
Wouldn't be like that without Bobby Jones.
No, sir. That's
right.
Anybody else? Well, let's get us a couple ushers. We'll take up our tithes and offering. They over yonder. I forgot to set them back on the thing. Jeff, you want to pray?
Yes, sir. Most kind, gracious, heavenly Father, Lord, we thank thee for this another opportunity we have to come to thy house to worship thee today, Lord. We thank thee, Lord, for the beautiful day you prepared for us and many blessings bestowed upon us this week, Lord, and for the blessings to come. Just be with us throughout the service today, Lord. And give Brother Gary the message you would have him speak, Lord. Pray, Lord, we'll all learn from it and go share it with others, Lord. And right now, we just pray for your blessings upon this offering, your offering, and do your good will. These things we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. In Bethlehem in Israel, this blessed babe was born to save us from our manger upon this blessed morn, to which his mother Mary did nothing take in store. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Oh, star of wonder, star of night, star with royal beauty bright, westward leading, still proceeding, guide us through thy perfect light. We three kings of Orient are bearing gifts. We travel so far, field and fountain, moor and mountain, following yonder star. Oh, star, wonder star of night, star with rose.
before we get into the announcements, I'll read a little bit more out of Luke. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over the flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and glory of the Lord shone round about them. They were sore afraid. The angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you this day is born in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, the angel were gone away from them into heaven. The shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. When they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things, pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them. Them shepherds could have just stayed in that field. They could have continued to sit right there and look after their flock. But they answered the call of God. They found the babe and told everybody what they had seen. Amen. Who have you told this week about that babe? Who have you told? All righty, announcements. Let's get to the church calendar. Jackson Smith will be here January the 7th. If it don't snow, sleet, ice over, he's coming. Or if Larry Stewart don't mess us up again. He was supposed to come one other time, and they had an open date, and then all of a sudden they didn't have no open date. So hopefully they won't be back on the road yet, and we can get him up here. But y'all tell everybody you know. And that's going to be a good day. He's going to come minister to us. Amen? All righty. I believe that takes us up to the prayer list. Prayer time. Amanda's already mentioned her cousin in St. Louis. It's Mackenzie. All right. That's already on the list. Y'all remember that child? RSV is what she's fighting. They had put her under some paralytics to try to fight it. She's in very, very, very bad shape. So y'all remember her. What else y'all got in a way of special requests for today? Anybody else? And who was the other one? I got you. All right. Anybody else? Got in? Come on in the house, bro. got any? Y'all remember Amanda? She's having some issues that could or could not be troublesome. I'm sure she'll have to go to the doctor once they all get back in the office and get checked out. So y'all just be in prayer about that. Why does that name sound familiar? Oh, yeah.
Now, all of a sudden, she's got 18 months to live.
Anybody else? And she's not the grandparent that's been having the mini strokes, right?
She's the one that's had some bleeding.
Yeah.
She's at the nursing home, but had another little problem Friday, but she's refusing to go back to the hospital.
Oh, yeah. And she's in her 90s. I think it was Sheila's mama that's had the mini strokes. Yeah. All right. Anybody else?
Yeah, I'm scheduled for an echo cardiogram. And, next month. Same day she goes back first time. But anyway, it's determined. Let's say I've got a bowel that's not doing right. This is to determine whether they can
put a stent in.
Yeah, put a stent in from the bottom up. Now, those are hard to say. I said, whatever you need to do, do it.
All right. Anybody else?
Pray for my mother. Hip replacement.
Which ain't but a week away.
Week from Tuesday.
Number two.
Turn Randall off. Anybody else? Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you today, God, just so thankful for the day you've given us, God. We are just so thankful, undeserving of the fact, God, that you sent your Son down to this old planet, God, to walk amongst a bunch of people that didn't like him, to walk amongst a bunch of people that didn't care for him, God, to be around people that didn't believe him. The Bible said he was tempted in all points, yet he wavered not. God, he didn't change. He stayed on the path. It was all about your will and not his. And God, we're thankful for that, because without that, we wouldn't be able to claim salvation. Without that, we couldn't live a holy life. Without that, God, there would be no heaven when we die. God, we're much thankful for that. God, we got several special requests today. God, we ask you to touch Chad Simmons. He's got COVID, and I don't think this has been the first time, but God, we just ask you, Lord, to touch him, put a hedge of protection around his daughter and wife, God, so they don't get sick. God, we're just trusting you to make it happen. God, Amanda, she's having some issues. It's just a little bump in the road, God, because we know you're in control. God, we know that you've got a hold of her life, God, and we're just trusting that. We're claiming that, God. For Amanda Johnson had a diagnosis that was pretty good, and then all of a sudden it wasn't, God, and now they're terminal, giving her up to 18 months to live, God, and we just wanting you to work in that situation, God, to touch that life, God, and God, she's got children and a husband, and we just ask, Lord, you be with that family, God, because they need you now more than ever. God, for Tim Moorfield's mother, possible stroke, she's on up there in age. God, nobody knows what tomorrow will bring, God, but we just ask you, Lord, to touch her. Touch her, God, and let them see your light through her. We know that can happen. God, for Mr. Bobby Jones, he's got to have some tests coming up, God, to determine whether they can put a stent in. How about, God, you just put your hand upon him, God, and touch his body and make it no need for the stent at all. Boy, wouldn't that be great. God, for Sandy, she goes in a week, God, to get this hip replacement surgery that she's been trying to get for a year or better. And God, we just ask the Lord, you keep her on the right path, let no thing come between her and that surgery. God, we're right here at the time. God, for these two families, the Brian Smith family and the James McKinney family. Oh, they're dealing with loss. Right here at the holidays. Vicki James dealing with loss right here at the holidays. We just ask you, Lord, to touch those families, God. Give them some peace and comfort in a way that only you can provide, Father. For that, we're thankful. Now, God, for the rest of the service today, God, we just ask, Lord, that you allow us to preach from the Word, God, and preach your Word. God, we ask you that you let us glorify your Son, the sacrifices he made. Father, bless the music, the message. These things we ask in Jesus' sweet holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, we had a request, and since it's my favorite Christmas song, I felt obliged to slide it right in there. So this for you, Bobby.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know your baby boy, he'll calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you kiss your little baby, you have kissed the face of God. The blind will see. Did you know your baby boy? Oh, he's Lord of all creation. Mary, did you know your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the
great. Sing. Once you get to watching, you know, you get caught up watching the Mark Lowry comedy, you forget he can sing. And you put Guy Penrod and David Phelps with him and Gordon Mode on the piano. It's like an all-star band. That song right there wasn't written by a man. God wrote that. God wanted to tell his story, his way, and he wrote that. Amen. Just bring it. I tried to find a meme with the rock in it, saying that, but, you know, he's always got to add language after it that really ain't fit for the church, so I had to scrap that idea. But just bring it. We're going to read 12 verses of Scripture that I really think is the last passage of Scripture I preached on. But it's okay. I mean, y'all believe we're going to have... It's a whole lot of stuff. I know a preacher that preached on John 3:16 for one entire year. He sure did it. John 3:16. It ain't that many words. But every message, every service was a different thought, different word, different idea, all from one verse. So, Matthew chapter 2, we're going to read the first 12 verses. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him." When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, "In Bethlehem of Judea. For thus it is written by the prophet, and thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel." Then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search diligently for the young child. When you have found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also." When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, fell down and worshiped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way. And when they came, when they were coming to the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother and fell down, worshiped him. When they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Brother Brent, will you pray? Amen. So looking at verse 11, a couple things. How many times in your life have you saw the manger scene? It had three shepherds, three wise men, Joseph, Mary, and the baby. Well, we read about the shepherds earlier, right? They came and found the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes. The three wise men, the three kings, the three magi, whatever you want to call them, they came and found the young child. You understand the difference? They came and found the young child with Mary his mother. And immediately the Bible says they fell down and worshiped him. So then I got to thinking, I got to looking. It said they opened their treasures. They come bearing gifts. Anybody know what frankincense was? A perfume. That one is a perfume. Frankincense, myrrh. Anybody got a shot? It's oil. You were right on that one, Amanda. You just had it to the wrong one. So, frankincense and myrrh. So, frankincense was a perfume, oil used to anoint the child, and gold. Well, who can't use a little money? I mean, I'm being serious. They had to go pay their taxes, right? They have to live, right? So all of that come together. So the magi, the three kings, the wise men, whatever you want to call them, they came to worship the young child as God had directed them, as God had told them. So with that said, do we do that? Do we come worship the child? Sometimes I don't think we do. Sometimes I think we just go through the motions. Sometimes I just think it. You know, I've always said that church got to be a habit. It does. It does, but it's got to evolve into something else. You following with me? Going to church got to be a habit, but it needs to evolve. Just like Paul said that babes desire the sincere milk of the word. You got to feed a baby milk. You can't. I think I may have, though. I think Mom and Daddy might have raised me on ribeye. Well, no, I take that back. My daddy was too tight for the ribeye. We eat the round steak. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You know what I mean? Got cut it in little bitty pieces, because if you don't, you ain't going to chew it up. But you can't start a baby out on meat. Got to be on milk. It's got to graduate. Well, Christians got to be the same way. They got to start out on the milk of the word, and they got to graduate. They got to evolve into more and more. And that is where we get stagnant, we get stopped, we get stuck in our tracks, and we never become anything other than just saved. And I don't mean that in a bad way, but there is so much more to the Christian life than being just saved. See, when I get just saved, I don't care about telling anybody about what I have. I don't care about it telling anybody about what I got. I don't care if my light shines. I don't care what I do in life. I don't care how much I do for God. I'm just saved. It's a bad place to be. It's a bad place to be. So we look at here in verse 11, they came, they worshiped the child, but they didn't come empty-handed. They didn't come empty-handed. And y'all sitting there going, oh, no, he gonna preach on tithes. That's a negative. It's a negative. They didn't come empty-handed. They brought gold. They brought a little money. They brought frankincense. They had a little perfume. They brought something for Mary. Give her a little perfume. And they give oil. So what do we bring? What do we bring? What do we bring to Jesus? Well, let me tell you what we can bring. We can bring anything. We can bring anything. We can bring everything. Do y'all understand what I'm saying? We can bring our biggest problems. Who better to solve your problems than God the Father himself, than Jesus himself? Who better to solve your issues? So you bring your problems to God. You bring how many? Well, you know, health-wise, my wife been through a little bit of rough times the last few years. What you can do with that is you can bring your biggest questions to God. It's okay to ask why. It is. Might not like the answer, but it's okay to ask why. It's the proper thing to do is to ask why. You bring all of that and you lay it at God's feet. That's what he said. So you got to bring it. You got to bring your biggest questions. This ties right in the next one. You bring your biggest health issues and you give them to God. You give them to God. You bring your health issues, you give them to God, and you say, God, I can't do anything. Well, first off, I'm not a doctor. Unless you want me to drive a nail in it, but I'm done. That's all I got. I'm a carpenter by trade. I don't know nothing else. So when I get in them situations, I get in them issues, I've got to turn it over to God because he knows everything. So I got to give it to him. So if you got a lot of problems and you got some questions, you got health issues, you know what that leads to? Burdens. And when you get burdened down, and when you get bogged down, and when you get in a time in your life that you are just absolutely overcome, overwhelmed, over everything, guess what? You give that to God. You bring it right to him. But all we got to do, we got to bring it. It's not going to get to God by itself. God's not going to come and grab it from you. You got to give it to him. You understand the difference? You got to give it to him. So we got our heaviest burdens, everything in life. How many of y'all believe that sometimes life will get you down? Sometimes life will grab you by the neck and squeeze. Sometimes life will grab you around the throat and try to choke your life out of you, just choke you down, bog you down. And we forget that little baby that was born in a manger didn't stay a baby. He's back at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for you and I. He didn't stay there. He didn't stay a little small child as he was when the wise men came. He didn't stay there. He's not that 12-year-old boy that was teaching in the synagogue and astounding the scholars, is what the Bible says. He didn't stay there. Well, it's pretty easy to teach on what you wrote. Y'all picking up what I'm laying down? He was teaching God's word. And the Bible said that he is the word. Right? But he didn't stay there. He walked this earth for 33 and a half years. He had a ministry that was 3.5 years long. And in that ministry, he healed the sick. He raised the dead twice. Twice. One of them, he commanded Lazarus to come out of that tomb. And the other one, he told that man to go on home. His daughter would be all right. Remember that? He wasn't even there. And she got up. What you want to bet, and I wished I'd have been there, but and I might get to ask them one day, but I can imagine that daddy walking up in the yard and that daughter come running out the door to greet him. But Jesus didn't just work those miracles. Jesus bled and died on the cross so that you and I can be saved, so that you and I can know heaven, so that you and I can live to sleep no more, as the song says. It said, when I wake up to sleep no more. Remember that one? Well, it's hard to beat some of them old songs, you know what? So we go through all of that, every bit of it. We bring God all our problems, every one of them. We drop them off. You know what you can bring him? Nobody wants to talk about this. We can bring him our biggest sin. Biggest thing. The biggest one. The biggest one. The baddest one. The ugliest one. The one you don't ever want to talk about. You can bring it to him and guess what? Psh, gone. Wiped out. It's like it never happened. It's like it never happened. We bring him our biggest sin and he'll transform our lives. He'll turn it into something else for his glory. You understand what I'm saying? He'll turn it into something for his glory. So we can bring him our worst sin and he'll change it and he'll forgive that. He'll forgive it. When you bring him your biggest sin, then you can also bring him your emptiest heart. Y'all understand? Your emptiest heart. You bring him your emptiest heart. What's he going to do with that? He's going to fill it up. He'll fill it up. If you bring your emptiest heart, he'll fill it up. And once you do that, once you get see this thing and come full circle, you bring him your emptiest heart and you've confessed your sin. You bring him that empty heart and you get all that stuff out of it. And then you let God fill it back up with himself. And what happens next is then you can begin to bring him your best efforts. God's going to fill it up, bro. I'm going to live the perfect, sinless, spotless life, not unless your name's Jesus. It's not going to happen. But what'll happen is as soon as something happens in your life that is not exactly lining up with the walk of Jesus Christ, there'll be a light go off, a bell a ding like a timer on the oven, and you'll say, oh no, I done messed up. And Paul said you got to crucify the flesh daily, which means you got to ask for forgiveness daily, because daily we all sin. That's just a fact. It's a known thing. But what we can't do is go into life knowingly sinning and continuing to commit the same sin over and over and over and over. That ain't going to get us to heaven. We got to live this life the right way. And then we can begin to bring, once he fills us up, we can begin to bring our best efforts. Our best efforts. Try to live our life in the most godly way possible. How do we do that? Well, one, we got to stay in contact with the author of the book. Number two, we got to do all things to glorify him, not us. Not your husband, not your wife, not your daddy, not your mama. Your grandma being saved ain't going to get you to heaven. You can't, but look, I got a godly grandma in heaven. I can honor her by being able to see her again one day. You understand what I'm saying? But I've got to put God, I got to stay in constant contact with him. I've got to communicate with him. I got to let him lead my life the way he see fit. And I've got to honor his decision. What's that mean? I can't fight and argue with him. If he tells you to go left, go left. If he tells you to go right, go right. And at that point in time, the time to ask why is over. Just go right. You understand what I'm saying? Do exactly what he says. Now, this last one, once you bring him your best effort, then you can bring your gifts. I can't look over at the people that sing. I might have to look at the door. I might have to look at the door, Stephen, keep myself out of trouble. If God gives you a gift, no matter what it is, you need to bring it. If God gives you if you can wrap presents like nobody else, then you need to go somewhere where they're wrapping presents, and you need to hang out right there and wrap them. You following with me? If you can paint, if God give you the ability to unstop a toilet, see me after church. We're going to thank him right here today. But if God give you the opportunity, the ability to paint, to clean up, to do work around his house, to help others. I had a lady come up to me at the gas pump the other day wanting a little bit of change. I don't care what the story is. I don't care. I really don't. But I give her, you know, we give her a dollar. That's about all we had. We give her a dollar. It's okay. I can't control what she does with that dollar. But I did my part. If the story is true, glory to God. If not, shame on her. So we bring our gifts, whatever that gift may be, whatever it is. That's what we do. We just bring it. Well, what do we do when we bring it? We give it to God. Because what happens when we give it to God? God will multiply it. And then God will send it back out. You understand what I'm saying? He'll send it back out. Let God do what God needs to do with whatever gift you give him. He'll do what he needs to do, and you have fulfilled your obligation. You understand what I'm saying? Today we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. What we got to do is realize that he didn't stay a baby. We can't worship a baby. We can't worship a man. But we can worship a holy God. And that's what he is. Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand. Now, Bobby Jones had a request. There's a few songs in life that man didn't, there's no way man could write. Man don't have enough smarts to write them. Mary, did you know? I would almost buy that man wrote that except for one line in that where it says, Mary, when you kissed your little baby boy, you were kissing the face of God. Man can't come up with that. It's not possible. God inspired that. None of us was at the birth of Jesus. None of us was there when the wise men came. So there's another song that's not really a Christmas song, but it is one that I can guarantee you, man didn't write. And it's I Can Only Imagine. It applies at Christmas too, because we can only imagine the events that unfolded in the life of Christ. We can only imagine what happened. And we can only imagine what happens if we're saved and we spend eternity in heaven living an everlasting life. Amen?
Amen.
Let's sing.
Imagine what it will be like
when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Sing hallelujah. Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing and hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Amen. What a great song. Whatever you think heaven's going to be like, it's not enough. When you read the description of that city built four square in Revelation, and what you're seeing in your mind as you read it, walls of jasper, gates of pearl, streets as gold, of pure gold as it was crystal. I ain't never seen any clear gold. You can try to imagine it. But when we get there, it's going to be a whole lot more than we think. Amen. All righty. Glad y'all came. Come on back next Sunday at our regularly scheduled and appointed time. And Jeff and Kim have been early 3 weeks in a row. I told him I thought he was like old state worker. He was banking that time so he could be 15 minutes late one and still be on. He's got it saved up. He'll cash it in all at once. But we're glad y'all came. Glad y'all come and spent a little bit of Christmas Eve with us. Now, go enjoy your time with family, even if you don't like them. Smile. It'd be like old Hee-Haw, gloom, despair, and agony on me. Oh, it'll be all right. Amen. Stephen dismisses. Amen.